Up next, we have our final company from the international track, which is Thunderstruck Resources, who's exploring for copper, zinc, and gold in Fiji. CEO Bryce Bradley is going to be presenting, and Rob Crystal, VP Business Development. Thunderstruck trades on the TSXV under the ticker AWE.
Hello, Deborah. And here's Bryce.
Why don't you go ahead and give us a little bit of background on yourself while Rob figures out the presentation?
Oh, of course. So before I started this company, I started it with Brian London, who's our chairman, and he runs the New Orleans Investment Conference. He writes Gold Newsletter, and he's one of the bigger shareholders as well as I am. And so before this, I used to raise capital for, I worked with and also had my own small investment banks in Toronto and also in Vancouver. And we raised capital for primarily exploration companies, but also some solar, and then uranium was big, 2005, et cetera. So I was doing that, but then we're talking to Brian, I've known him many, many years. We thought, why we don't know what's going on the inside of these companies when you're just financing them, getting a bit of commission, maybe being a shareholder. And so if they're misspending them, or we don't know what they're doing, it bodes poorly for us and our future relationships with all of these investors. And of course, in that time, I had built up a nice network of investors and a relatively good reputation, I think. So we decided to just start our own company. And the idea was that we would start a company with good commodities. We were commodity agnostic. However, we wanted good commodities. So we have gold. Of course, he wanted gold. He writes Gold Newsletter. And he loves precious metals, and the New Orleans conference loves precious metals. So we wanted, of course, gold, silver, and then in this package, we have zinc and copper as well. We wanted a good jurisdiction, like low political risk, and then Fiji just landed on our lap. So we decided we were going to stay as director. He's a chairman, so we know what's going on the inside, and then I could run it. And we would just hire a really good technical team. So we didn't even know where Fiji was. Can you get off of the forward-looking statements?
Yeah.
Rob, maybe go to there. Okay. Sure. So whatever, I'm just going to banter. So this landed on our laps, and we gave it out to a bunch of a few analysts who were like, where is Fiji? Because I'm from Canada. He's from the US. Where is he? I had to look it up on a map. Of course, I knew it existed, had never been there. But Fiji's around 2,800 kilometers from New Zealand. I think that's the closest, first world country. Oh, you can see it there on the snapshot. It has around 900,000 people, 500,000 on this main island. There's 332 islands in general. But the rocks are young. I'm not a geologist. But the rocks are really young, like 25 million years or under. And it's it's really underexplored because of its remoteness. And so people at the time were saying, it's so remote. Why would we invest there? And I said, it's precisely because it was so remote that it's not been picked over. And it's just ripe for exploration at this time. Now, and the positive thing is that because the Vatukoula gold mine, you can see to the north of on this map, it's been in production for 80 years. So that means several things for Thunderstruck Resources. One, we have there's a skilled labor force on this tiny island who have been working, or their fathers or their grandfathers have been working at the Vatukoula gold mine, which employs, it's still in production still, and employs 1,500 people. So it's very easy for us to get skilled labor force. It also means that the island is mining friendly. It means that they have a mineral resource department that that adheres to the English mining law. And so it's not we don't have to explain to the locals what it is that we're doing. And because of Vatukoula gold mine and these other projects that you see on the island here, they built up a full infrastructure down, there's a road, a really good paved road that goes all the way around the island. And then there's a lot of logging roads going into the interior, especially where we are. And Suva, that you see over to the bottom east, has a deep water port. That's their capital. So that's not an issue. And you can see Newcrest is right down here as well. They've been in the country for many years, and they have a really large copper gold porphyry that they're in a JV with Mitsubishi, Japanese. Japanese also really like Fiji for its proximity, and also just because it's underexplored. So we went in there, picked up what we thought were the best assets so far. We still want to pick up more assets. We want to be, you know, have first mover advantage as a company. Because I'm here now due to the pandemic, you know, there's so many negative things about this pandemic, but one good thing that's come out of this is that, you know, now I can do virtual conferences and also be on the ground instead of trying to be in two places at once to move this company forward. We have four main assets. Liwa Gold is our, even though we have it here as our first one, it's our least explored asset, actually. So this is the only one that does not have any drilling on it yet, but we have done a lot of work on it in the last, I think, 3 years. And as you can see, almost everywhere we touch just comes back high grade gold. And I mean, it's almost like we don't even know where to begin. It's so amazing. So we have delineated four main targets so far. Can you go to that? There we go. Now, I know you can't really see the grades on this, but you saw the grades on the other page. Rob, is it 3 kilometers, I think, right? So far from
the
bottom to, yeah, trending east-west. And four drillable targets. We have the gentleman, Oliver, coming in from Gibraltar, who did his master's thesis. He's just recently graduated. He did his master's thesis on this gold asset. And he did a lot of this mapping here. He's going to be coming to the country very, very, very soon to work for us full time and to do more mapping to find out where else we should be drilling. And we're hoping to get to do a full drill program this season. Oliver will be in charge of trying to organize what our exploration program is going to look like for this. But this is our most, I mean, would you say, Rob, it's our most exciting, I guess, exciting project because...
Very, very exciting project that both the company and shareholders have been waiting patiently for us to get drilling. We did attempt late last year. We did start a hole, and we had to evacuate the property due to Cyclone Yaza. But this is a drill ready property that we're very excited to get back on this season.
Right. Yeah. So this one, is high priority. We did IP on it, as you can see, and that IP showed anomalous values going down, I think, around 500 meters or so, right over where we had done a lot of trenching and mapping. So let's just hope it goes to depth. We don't know yet. This is what makes this one so exciting. And so the next project we have is Coracayu. This is the only one we have that so far is in a joint venture. And we will be owning, if we continue into a joint venture with the group, it will be owning 70%, 30%. JOGMEC, which is a Japanese governmental exploration entity, has done the joint venture with us. As you can see here, it's like $3.5 million over 3 years. We're in our last year. Now, because of COVID, we may end up doing another year next year. We're bouncing around ideas because last year was slowed down, of course, with trying to get people in and out and get things done on time. But we've just press released, right, Rob? We just press released a few days ago. The program for the, at least the phase one for Coracayu is fully funded. So, and we have the team here. They're ready to go on Monday. Yeah. So next Monday.
Here's our 2021 program. The camp is getting supplied right now as we speak, and the teams will be up there on Monday starting the work. This map here is just a soil sampling grid where they'll be doing the geochemical soil sampling and rock sampling is the first part of the first phase.
Right. So we finished the roads. We just had to clear out some landslides and whatnot. It's because it's fairly remote. We have a full camp already built there. And so that's all ready to go. Happy times on that one. Ramo, because so our last two properties, the last two properties we have are 100% owned by us, but we are looking for joint venture partners. We are under NDA with several companies for a variety of possible different business combinations, let's just say, mergers, acquisitions, etc. So our Ramo Copper Gold has been drilled by Anglo back in the day, and this is one reason we wanted it. It came back high, very low grade, you know, like copper porphyries tend to be, low grade copper, you know, some good gold in there. And we have all of the data, and we did a bunch of work, but just surface work so far on this property. And it's all packaged up, kind of ready to go. It needs deep drilling to continue to see how large this copper porphyry might be. And the gold is really interesting. So if we have time this year, I want to send a geo out there to check out the gold to the south that we've already done a lot of work on. We made a gold discovery kind of to the south of this, of Rama, kind of on the fringe of the porphyry. So that's all good to go. And then the last one is Nicoro. It also was drilled by Anglo back in the 70s. So this was nice when we were trying to negotiate to get the properties. We had all of this data to look at, and the analysts, of course, loved it. So this came back with a tiny, tiny resource because they didn't do a lot of work. And we don't know why they left. It's the 70s, but 450,000 tons at, you know, almost 12% zinc and, you know, 0.64% copper. Again, we may joint venture that. Not sure. We may also just do some more work on it ourselves. This is our team, or their management team, rather, myself. I already talked about myself. These are all the directors. And we've known most of these people for many years, 20 years or more in the industry. And I think that's about all the time we have. But Rob Crystal is our VP Business Development and large shareholder. And he's fully available for you in Vancouver on the Vancouver time zone. I am less available given the time zone, but to the extent that anyone wants to ask me any more questions about Fiji or what it's like here or anything, please, you can always email me as well.
Yes, and a quick comment that absolutely we went through this deck relatively quick. It is on our webpage. So please have a review and then reach out to me, phone or email. I'm more than happy to fill in any details. I know this is a quick presentation, but I'm available most days 24/7 if you want to reach out to me.
We actually have a couple minutes left if anyone in the audience has some questions. And great presentation. Thanks so much. I don't know Fiji. I've never been there. So it's interesting to hear about what's going on there. Just if you could leave us maybe with some of the catalysts that we can expect over the coming months.
Oh, yes, of course. So Rob and I and the rest of the team, we're going to do a financing soon. I don't think we haven't announced it yet, but we're going to do a financing to finance the Liwa asset, the zinc copper one, the Korakayu joint venture that we have with Japanese. That one, as I said, is fully funded, and they also fund, you know, a lot of our, you know, of our office rent and our vehicles and whatnot. But we will be wanting to finance the Liwa gold drilling program and exploration program. What else? Do we have any other?
Yeah, just a little footnote to that. We do have sort of cash in the till, so to speak. But with Oliver coming in, who did his master's thesis, there's been a lot of discussion about doing a much larger, aggressive drill program on that property. And we think the timing is right to do a financing so that once Oliver hits the ground and we, instead of doing sort of just 1,000 meters drilling, we might expand that quite aggressively throughout the dry season this year.
Oh, you're right. Good point.
And in terms of expanding your drill program, would that involve getting more rigs? Is rig availability an issue in Fiji?
Well, I'll answer that, Bryce. We right now, yes, there are rigs on the island. There are rigs close in what was South Pacific, New Zealand, Australia. And Bryce and I and the team, we are currently, we're entertaining a number of options that are in sort of the final stages as to what's going to be the most economical and the sort of the best bang for the dollar. We're very aware of our spend. We run a very lean sort of ship, so to speak. And so we're just reviewing and going to make some final decisions of who is going to actually come in and do the program, both for Korokayu and for Liwa.
And what are drilling costs like on the island?
I would say it's very similar to, you know, a Canadian North America program. You know, there is a lot of skilled labor here on the island, and the equipment there. As I said, there's equipment on the island that is readily can be available. But we're also looking at bringing in some equipment from close by within the South Pacific. Cost wise, it's very, very similar. Our targets are very shallow in both cases for Korokayu and Liwa. So we're not going down 2,000 meters or anything like that. Most of our targets on Korokayu in the last couple of drill seasons have been 150, 200 meters. It looks like it's a very open pittable scenario if it goes to that direction of development. It looks like a very relatively economic open pit scenario.
Okay. And so one final question just about the drilling. So if you do increase your coffers and start a more aggressive drill program, what kind of turnaround times can we expect on results? Where do you send the...
good question. So Rob's correct that in the end, the drilling costs tend to be similar probably to industry standards, maybe in Canada. But, initially they're cheaper because, you know, you have cheaper labor and we have, as he said, very shallow drilling. You know, it's even on the gold, we're not going to be drilling deep, but because there's no assay lab on the island, that adds costs to the per meter rate overall, because we have to send them to Brisbane. Now we were sending them to Perth, to ALS. And now I believe that we're sending them to Brisbane, where it's a little bit cheaper. I mean, it's a little bit faster turnaround, and I think it was 3 weeks, something like this, huh, Rob?
Yeah. About three weeks has been the standard the last couple of years to turn around from Australia.
Okay, great. Well, looking forward to seeing some results. Thanks for presenting. If you ever feel like doing a site visit, I think that you've had
We intended to do a site visit last June.
Yes.
Like last, exactly a year ago. And we had it all teed up with analysts, large shareholders. We're really excited about that. And of course, then everybody we had to cancel. COVID hit in March. So now we're still waiting. But yes, we absolutely do intend to do that. Yes. And now I know all the hot spots.
Right. Well, I look forward to that. I look forward to seeing your results this summer. Thanks for taking the time to participate.
You bet. Thank you so much for hosting and having us on the show. Thank you so much.